Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 18th of July 2019. Displayed are the list of news articles taken up for today's analysis, along with the page numbers of Chennai, Bengaluru, Delhi and Thiruvananthapuram editions. Let us now start our analysis. The first news article is about the final judgment of the International Court of Justice in Kulbhushan Jadhav case. The syllabus with which the analysis of this news article can be linked is given here for your reference. Now let us start with the news article analysis. The article states that International Court of Justice has given its final judgment on Kulbhushan Jadhav case. Also, the verdict declares that the International Court of Justice has accepted India's plea against Pakistan. So, this case was between India and Pakistan. Now, let us know the background of this particular case. Kulbhushan Jadhav is a former Indian naval officer, and from March 2016, he has been in the custody of Pakistani authorities. The circumstance of his apprehension or arrest, according to India, was that he was kidnapped from Iran and then he was transferred from Iran to Pakistan. Later, he was detained for interrogation or questioning by the Pakistani authorities. In contradiction to this, Pakistan claims that Mr. Jadhav was arrested in Balochistan, which is near the border with Iran, after he illegally entered Pakistani territory. Pakistan accuses Kulbhushan Jadhav of performing acts of espionage and terrorism on behalf of India. Now, know the meaning of espionage. Espionage is the practice of spying or of using spies by the governments to obtain political and military information about another country. After this arrest was made, immediately the High Commission of India in Islamabad, which is the capital of Pakistan, requested the consular access to Mr. Jadhav at the earliest to the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of Pakistan. Here, consular access means giving access to the consul in a foreign country, and a consul is an official who is appointed by a country to live in a foreign city and to protect the country's citizens and interests in that particular foreign city. Or in simple words, we can say a consul is an ambassador. So in this context, the ambassador of India to Pakistan has requested permission and access to meet Kulbhushan Jadhav. But if you see, Pakistan denied the consular access of India to Kulbhushan Jadhav. Then in April 2017, he was sentenced to death by the Pakistan military court. As a result of this, India filed a case against Pakistan in the International Court of Justice on May 2017. India stated that Pakistan has violated the Vienna Convention on Consular Relations of 1963. This is because the Vienna Convention on Consular Relations of 1963 establishes consular relations between states, and this consular relations takes place by mutual consent. India and Pakistan both have accession to the convention. If you see here, accession is the act in which a state or country that has not signed a treaty expresses its consent to become a party to that treaty. Now, this consent is expressed by depositing an instrument of accession. So, accession has the same legal effect as ratification, acceptance or approval. Accession is generally used when the deadline for signature of a treaty has passed and the state wants to express their consent to that treaty, which makes them bound or committed to that treaty. However, many modern multilateral treaties are providing for accession even during the period when the treaty is open for signature. So, since India and Pakistan have accessed the convention, they are bound to the rules which are mentioned in the convention. Now, you may think why India filed a case or application in International Court of Justice. This is because of the optional protocol to the Vienna Convention on Consular Relations concerning the compulsory settlement of disputes. Both Pakistan and India are parties to this protocol and they have accessioned it. The Article 1 of the optional protocol provides that the disputes arising out of the interpretation or application of the Vienna Convention shall lie within the compulsory jurisdiction of the International Court of Justice. So, the dispute may accordingly be brought before the court through an application which can be made by any party which is involved in the dispute. Next, India claimed that Pakistan has acted in breach of its obligations under Article 36 of the Vienna Convention. Here, the Article 36 of this Vienna Convention facilitates the exercise of consular functions relating to the nationals or individuals of the sending state. In our context, the sending state is India and the receiving state is Pakistan. So, Article 36 facilitates the exercise of consular functions relating to the nationals of India. The article states that the consular officers shall be free to communicate with the nationals of the sending state, and the officers shall have access to the nationals. The article also states that the receiving state shall inform and forward communication to the consular post of the sending state. Now, this has to happen if a national of the sending state is arrested or committed to prison or custody because of a pending trial, or the national is detained in any other manner. The article states that the consular officers have the right to visit the national who has been arrested, or if he has been detained, or if he is in custody. Now, this is applicable even when there is an execution of the judgment. Like in this case, the judgment of Pakistan's army court, which gave a judgment that Kulbhushan Jadhav must be executed. So, from this article 36, we can clearly say that Pakistan should give consular access to the Indian ambassador to meet Kulbhushan Jadhav. Then, Pakistan should have informed India about the detention of Mr. Jadhav without any delay. But if you see, none of these provisions were executed by Pakistan. This is because Pakistan is claiming that the Vienna Convention does not apply in case of espionage. But the International Court of Justice has held that the Article 36 of the Vienna Convention does not exclude Pakistan from its scope for certain categories of persons, such as persons who are suspected of espionage. Pakistan has also claimed that the Vienna Convention does not apply in this case. Rather, the bilateral agreement of Pakistan and India on consular access, which was signed in the year 2008, only applies. Now, if you see, this bilateral agreement also provides for consular access within 3 months to the nationals of one country who is under arrest, detention, or imprisonment in any other country. But the International Court of Justice has ruled that in this case, the Vienna Convention applies and not the bilateral agreement between India and Pakistan. So, as a final judgment, the International Court of Justice stated that Pakistan has acted in breach of its obligations under Article 36 of the Vienna Convention. Now, the first breach is by not informing Mr. Kulbhushan Jadhav about his rights. The second breach is by not informing India about the arrest and detention of Mr. Kulbhushan Jadhav without delay. The third breach is that denying access to Mr. Kulbhushan Jadhav to the consular officers of India and denying to arrange for legal representation. So, the court has ordered the following. First, Pakistan has to inform Mr. Kulbhushan Jadhav without any further delay about his rights. Then, Pakistan has to give Indian consular officers access to him. Then Pakistan has to review and reconsider the conviction and sentence. And finally, the International Court of Justice has said that until the review and reconsideration is carried out, the execution of the judgment by the Pakistan military court has to be stayed. Now, this judgment is a victory to India because the court has accepted India's claims. If you see, Pakistan is also claiming victory by saying that the court has not accepted India's written and oral submissions. If you see, in the written and oral submissions which were given by India, India had asked for the cancellation of the Pakistani verdict. Now, let us see some facts about the International Court of Justice, because all along our news article analysis, we have been seeing about International Court of Justice. This International Court of Justice, or ICJ, is the principal judicial organ of the United Nations. If you see, it was established in June 1945 by the Charter of the United Nations, and it began its work in April 1946. The seat or the headquarters of this International Court of Justice is at the Peace Palace, which is situated in the Hague City of Netherlands. Also, note that out of the 6 principal organs of the United Nations, International Court of Justice is the only one which is not located in New York in the United States of America. It is located at Hague City, Netherlands. Now, this court's role is to settle legal disputes which are submitted to it by the states. Then also to give advisory opinions on legal questions which are referred to it by an authorized United Nations organs and United Nations specialized agencies. This will be carried out in accordance with the international law. Now, if you see, this court is composed of 15 judges, and they are elected by the United Nations General Assembly and the Security Council for the term of office of 9 years. So once they're elected, their term of office, or they will be in office for 9 years. And if you see, the judgments that are delivered by the court in disputes between the states are binding upon the parties which are concerned. This is provided by Article 94 of the United Nations Charter, if you see. In this charter, it is said that each member of the United Nations undertakes to comply with the decision of the court in any case to which it is a party. This means since Pakistan is a member of the United Nations, it has to comply with the judgment of International Court of Justice in this Kulbhushan Jadhav case. Also, these judgments are final and they cannot be appealed in any other court. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of this news article. Have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This editorial discusses about the role that India has to play at United Nations Security Council. The syllabus with which this editorial analysis can be linked is given here for your reference. We have seen in detail about United Nations Security Council and how the member nations of Asia-Pacific group have supported India's candidature to be non-permanent member of United Nations Security Council in our 27 June analysis. Just have a look at it for further subject clarity. Now, the main thing that you should know from that news article is that United Nations Security Council consists of 5 permanent members and 10 non-permanent members. And if elected, India will become a non-permanent member in United Nations Security Council in 2021 to 2022. Now, let us start the editorial analysis. The author tells that once India becomes a non-permanent member of UNSC, India should contribute towards playing a leading role in building a rule-based world order so that there will be stability and security prevailing across the world. The author tells that if India does that, then the developed and the developing countries would like to partner with India in the future. The author is telling that India should make use of this opportunity to project, that is, to show itself as a responsible nation to the world. Before seeing the suggestions that have been given by the author, first let us see the present scenario that is prevailing across the world, which has been discussed by the author. So he has given the subtitle in that editorial, which is Changing State of World. It simply means that the position or the stand of the countries of the world are changing continuously. The author tells that India is geographically present in a troubled region between West Asia and East Asia, that is in the South Asian region. He tells that this region is very active with conditions like insurgencies, that is revolts, then terrorism, then narcotics trafficking, which is nothing but drug trafficking, and also power rivalries exist. That is the fights or standoffs between two countries like, for example, India, Pakistan. Next, the author has mentioned that huge people are being dislocated in West Asia. Now, he's speaking about West Asia. He's telling that they are violently being displaced due to war. Then he tells that though the terrorist organizations like Islamic State of Iraq and the Levant, nothing but Daesh, has been defeated, Iraq and Syria are not going to perform like it was before the war conditions, because the people have moved away and also the governments not have enough resources to bring back the country to its original position like how it was before the war. Along with these, those persons, the author tells that those persons who are associated with Daesh have moved back to their countries and are now planning to cause issues or terrorism related incidents in their own countries. So this is becoming a global threat now. Next, the author mentions about the problems that are happening in North Asia. Here, he has specifically mentioned North Korea about its nuclear and missile tests. Then, he has also mentioned about Afghanistan, which is located in South Asia. Now, he tells that Afghanistan has slowly realized its mistake of having supported some terrorist groups like Haqqani Network, the Taliban and Al-Qaeda from functioning in its country. So now it's moving towards a civilian government. Next, the author has mentioned some of the problems of Asian continent. First is the strategic mistrust or a misperception between the neighboring countries or say a group of countries. If you see with respect to the neighboring countries, it is more or less regarding the border disputes or the territorial disputes. Here, border disputes means mostly the border lines which have not been clearly demarcated by both the countries, and because of this, there is a problem between those two countries. Next, the territorial disputes means one country occupying a portion of a neighboring country. For example, the Pakistan-occupied Kashmir or the Aksai Chin area between India and China. Next, the author tells that Asia is not having a pan-Asia security architecture. Pan-Asia means throughout Asia, and security architecture means a system of norms, practices, relationships, alliances or institutions which are constructed or developed by the nations to address, enhance or ensure international or regional security. Here it is the regional security with respect to Asia. Finally, the author tells that there is competition between the Asian countries over energy, that is nothing but the fossil fuels, like who will sell more fossil fuels and how to stop the other country's growth, etc. And there is also a fight with regarding the strategic minerals. We have seen some important issues that are pertaining to Asia now. Next, the author has discussed the position of the Western world. Here, Western world generally refers to the developing countries from the North American continents, like the countries of United States, Canada, and almost the majority of the European continent. He tells that once the Western world preached the universal values, like values which are common to all the people in the world, and also espoused it, that is, it supported or branded it as Western values. But now all these countries have changed their stand and they are supporting their own causes in the name of national interest. He tells that fear, populism, polarization and ultranationalism have become the basis of politics in many countries now. Here, fear means creating a fear or insecurity among their own country people. Then populism means political ideas and activities that are intended to get the support of ordinary people by giving them whatever they want. Then polarization means dividing the population into two sharply contrasting groups or sets of opinions or beliefs. And finally, ultranationalism means extreme nationalism, which promotes the interests of one state or the people above the other state or other country people. Here, a good example is the country of United States of America for this ultranationalism. The author tells that despite all this changing state of the world is in a better place today than when the UN was first established in the year 1945. One of the primary functions of the United Nations is to maintain international peace and security. Here the author tells that maintaining international peace and security has been positive, even with the presence of UN or even without the presence of UN. But the world is not united on fulfilling some other shared goals, especially if you see on international social and economic cooperation. Here, one example which you can see is the ongoing trade wars, especially the United States-China trade war. Here, the author suggests that the permanent members of United Nations Security Council and also the United Nations member nations must try to reform the United Nations Security Council. He tells that the coordination between these member nations might be difficult, but it is well worth trying. Then the author has mentioned the report which has been released by PricewaterhouseCoopers. Here, PricewaterhouseCoopers is a multinational professional services network which is based at or which has its headquarters at London, United Kingdom. This particular network releases a report called World in 2050 report. Now, in this report, it has been predicted that by the year 2050, China will be the world's number one economic power, followed by India. So India will be the second or the world's second economic power. So we can see that India will become a major power by the year 2050. The author tells that India's rise in the world stage is not recognized by the great powers and other world countries. In this scenario, the author has given some suggestions on what India should aim to do in order to gain the recognition of the world powers. If you see, India is pushing forward to become a permanent member of United Nations Security Council. But this move by India has not been supported or it has not been recognized at large either by the permanent five members, which are called P5 members, or by any other member nations of UN. The author tells that the permanent seat to India will come more by invitation than by self-canvassing, which means self-promotion by India. Here he just means to tell that a position should be given rather than being taken by promotion. To do this, the author suggests that India will have to increase its financial contribution towards the United Nations expenses. We know that United Nations is an international organization. Now, in order to run this institution, the member nations are voluntarily contributing some money. This is what we call it as financial contribution by the member nations. Now, the author tells that India's contribution is less than each of the P5 members. Even Germany and Japan contribute many times more than India. He tells that although India sends most of its forces for UN peacekeeping missions, its financial contribution towards the UN peacekeeping missions is also very less. So the author tells that India will have to increase its financial contribution towards the United Nations expenses overall. Next, the author tells that no country is taking a leadership role in the international stage on global issues, especially issues like security, migrant movement, poverty, and climate change. He suggests that India has an opportunity to promote well-balanced and common solutions for these problems. To this, the author has mentioned a 3-point agenda on what India must do. Now, focus on these 3-point agenda. The first agenda for India should be that, as a member of the United Nations Security Council, The author tells that India should work towards a rules-based global order. Here, sustainable development and promoting people's welfare should become the new drivers for a rules-based global order. So, based on some rules, the global countries or the world countries should function. So, this is called a rules-based global order. Here, he has mentioned a concept called humanitarian interventionism. Simply, it means that the developed nations try to push the regime change in the developing countries or in countries which are suffering from internal conflicts in the name of responsibility to protect. That is, the developed countries think that they have the responsibility to protect these developing countries. The author tells that it is not necessary at all. So, the author is suggesting that India should guide the United Nations Security Council in maintaining a rules-based global order which all the countries should follow. The second agenda should be to push the United Nations Security Council's Sanctions Committee to ensure that the committee targets all those individuals and entities who should be put with sanctions. If any individual or entity is working to disturb or disrupt the international peace and security, or when they are violating the human rights, or when they are involved in war activities, then sanctions may be put on them by the UNSC Sanctions Committee. The author tells that multilateral action by the UNSC has not been possible because of narrowly defined national interests. Now, what is the meaning of this sentence? We can explain with a very good example. The example is the Masood Azhar case. If you see, for a long time, United Nations was not able to designate him as a global terrorist and also put him in the sanctions list since China did not support. Finally, China supported and now he's designated as a global terrorist. So, the author is telling that multilateral action by the UNSC has not been possible because of narrowly defined national interests. Then, the author mentions that as on May 21st, 2019, 260 individuals and 84 entities have been subjected to United Nations sanctions. If you see the countries like United States of America, then the regional grouping like the European Union have their own sanctions list apart from this UN sanctions list. It means that the particular person or entity will not be engaged in any way with the countries like US or EU once they are put in the sanctions list of their countries. Next, let us see the third agenda which has been mentioned by the author. Here, the third agenda is India should once again become a consensus builder instead of the outlier it has progressively become. Here, he means to tell that India should actively engage in global level problems and help in mediating the conflicts instead of not taking part in them. Here, outlier means one who is having a different view and is staying out of a particular group. Now, in order to deal the global problems with respect to climate change, disarmament, terrorism, trade and development, a harmonized response is the most essential one, or a sine qua non. In the editorial, it is mentioned as sine qua non, which means it is an essential one. Here, harmonized response means common agreement or a common solution to any problems. Only if India helps in bringing a common solution to the problem, then it would be respected at the world level. Instead, just being an outlier is not going to help India in the long run. The author also tells that India should take the responsibility of larger burdens like maintaining global public goods and also building new regional public goods. One area which the author suggests is in the area of security. He tells that India should take the lead in activating, that is, starting the United Nations Security Council's Military Staff Committee. If you see, this committee was never started at all since the start of United Nations, that is since 1945. He tells that without Military Staff Committee, the United Nations Security Council's collective roles on security and conflict resolution will continue to remain limited, which means the security concerns and the conflict resolution concerns will not be addressed completely. Now, let us come to the final part of the editorial. Here, the author has given some common suggestions to India. We saw that the Western nations are becoming more nationalistic, that is, they are working for their own individual interests. The author tells that this will never work for a country like India. He suggests that India should follow multilateralism. So, he has mentioned the word in the editorial that embracing the multilateral ethic is the best way forward. Next, the author tells that a rules-based international order will help India. We saw what a rules-based international order was during our editorial analysis. Just have a look at it. Then, the author predicts that India will be a rich country in the future and also will have greater military powers. But India's population will remain relatively poor when compared to other countries. He tells that India is a great nation, but it is not a great power. Next, the author tells that India should strongly follow polycentrism. Here, poly means many and centrism simply means center. It is always better for India to engage with many centers or many powers instead of engaging with one power at one time. So, this is called as polycentrism, to engage with many centers. If you see, most of the developed nations will not prefer to be polycentric because they like to have their own group of countries on whom they can influence or impose their values. So, the author is suggesting that India should strongly follow polycentrism. Finally, the author has mentioned that India cannot work confidently in the global stage if the relations with its neighbors are not stable. So, the author is telling that along with its engagements in United Nations and also in the United Nations Security Council, India must also actively engage with South Asia and especially with its neighboring countries. With this, we come to the end of the editorial analysis. Now, have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article is about the rotavirus vaccine. The syllabus to which the analysis of this news article can be linked is displayed here for your reference. Now, let us see the news article. The news article states that the Karnataka State Health Department is going to introduce rotavirus vaccine as a part of the Universal Immunization Program, or in short UIP. This will be introduced in the third week of the month of August. First, let us see the immunization program. The immunization program in India was introduced in the year 1978 as Expanded Program of Immunization. If you see, it was introduced by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India. Then in 1985, the program was modified as Universal Immunization Program, or in short UIP. UIP is implemented in a phased manner to cover all the districts in the country by the year 1989-1990, and it is one of the largest health programs in the world. If you see, the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare provides several vaccines to infants, children and pregnant women through this universal immunization program. Then in the year 1992, this universal immunization program became a part of Child Survival and Safe Motherhood program. Then since the year 1997, the immunization activities have been an important component of National Reproductive and Child Health Program. It is currently one of the key areas under the National Rural Health Mission. So, under the Universal Immunization Program, the Government of India is providing vaccination to prevent many vaccine preventable diseases such as diphtheria, pertussis, tetanus, polio, measles, then severe form of childhood tuberculosis and hepatitis B and also diarrhea. Now, normally the rotavirus vaccine costs around Rs 600 a dose in the private healthcare facilities. Now, if the rotavirus vaccine becomes a part of UIP in Karnataka, then this vaccine will be given free of cost. It will be given to all the infants at the age of 6 weeks, then at 10 weeks, and then again at 14 weeks. It will be provided at all the government hospitals, then at medical colleges, then at urban dispensaries, primary healthcare centers, community health centers, and then at sub-centers, and also at outreach session sites. Here, outreach means the delivery of services to the people who stay far away from the health facility. And vaccines need to be delivered to their villages and areas for the immunization sessions. Also know that outreach sites have no arrangement for overnight storing of vaccines. The trips to the outreach sites for the immunization sessions are completed within a day. In India, the outreach sites are generally sub-centers, then the Anganwadi centers, then the urban session sites, and also the village session sites, etc. Now, let us know about this rotavirus and rotavirus vaccine. First, let us see about the rotaviruses. They are classified as a genus in the family of Rioviridae. Rotavirus is a highly contagious virus, if you see. It is the most common organism that causes severe diarrhea, and it also causes death among children under the age of 5. This is because the rotaviruses infect nearly every child by the age of 3 to 5 years. They are globally the leading cause of severe dehydrating diarrhea in children who are aged less than 5 years, if you see. Now, according to the World Health Organization, in the low-income countries, the median age at which the primary rotavirus infection occurs is from 6 months to 9 months. And 80% of the disease occurs among infants who are less than 1 year old. But if we consider high-income countries, according to World Health Organization, the first episode of rotavirus infection can be occasionally delayed and it occurs usually at the age of 2 to 5 years. But still, majority of the infection occurs in infancy, as about 65% of the infection occurs among infants who are less than 1 year old. Now, according to the news article, in India, Around 78,000 children die from this rotavirus diarrhea annually, that is every year. Nearly 9 lakh children are admitted to the hospitals with severe diarrhea. Also, if you see, according to the UNICEF global database of 2018, diarrhea as the cause for the child mortality or diarrhea as a cause for the death of children in India is 9.2%. The World Health Organization position paper on rotavirus the year 2013 states that the transmission of this virus occurs primarily by the fecal-oral route. Here, fecal-oral transmission means that the germs that cause illness are found in the stool or feces of an infected person and they are spread to another person. This occurs when a person touches the stool of an infected person or when a person touches an object that is contaminated with the stool of an infected person and that person gets ingested with the germs. This is because an object or surface can appear clean but it can still have germs that can cause illness. Disease that is spread by the fecal-oral route can be transmitted from person to person or through food or even through water. This can happen when a person fails to wash their hands properly after using the bathroom, when he handles food that is eaten by others, or when feces contaminate a water supply. So, rotavirus can transmit directly from person to person. So, remember this, it can transmit directly from person to person. And also indirectly via contaminated fomites, that is the objects or materials which are likely to carry infection such as clothes, utensils and furniture. This rotavirus infection affects primarily the small intestinal villi in our human body. Here know that villi are the small finger-like projections which are present in the small intestine. They help to absorb the digested food. This infection reduces the absorptive capacity of the villi, which results in diarrhea. If you see this rotavirus diarrhea as an incubation period of 1 to 3 days, the symptoms of this disease are a sudden onset of watery stools, which is often accompanied by fever and vomiting. Sometimes there can also be abdominal pain. The diarrhea and the associated symptoms may last 3 to 7 days if you see. If it is not treated, then it may result in dehydration, then electrolyte imbalance, shock, and it can even lead to death. So that is why providing immunization to this disease is of much importance. Now, immunization is the process by which a person is made immune or resistant to an infectious disease by the administration of a vaccine. So if you give a vaccine, that particular person acquires immunity or becomes resistant to a particular infectious disease. So, we can tell vaccines are substances that stimulate the body's own immune system. And this protects the person against infection or disease. So, for protecting rotavirus, there is a rotavirus vaccine or we call it as RVV. This vaccine gives protection to infants and children against the rotavirus diarrhea. So, 3 doses of vaccine are given at 6 weeks, then at 10 weeks, then at 14 weeks of the age of the infant. Then 4 oral live attenuated rotavirus vaccines are available internationally if you see and they are all pre-qualified by the World Health Organization. Here, attenuated means the force of the vaccine virus is reduced. The 4 vaccines are Rotarix, Rotatec, Rotavac and Rotaseal. All 4 vaccines are considered as highly effective in preventing severe gastrointestinal disease. So, just remember the names because everywhere you can see Rota, Rota, Rota. You can easily remember the vaccines. So, just have an idea about these vaccines. Now, have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article is about the appropriation bill. The syllabus with which the analysis of this news article can be linked is displayed here for your reference. Now, let us see the news article. Now, the term appropriation means a sum of money which is allocated officially for a particular use. Now, consider the case of Parliament because the news is that appropriation bill has been passed by the Lok Sabha. Every year, the government tables the union budget in the Parliament. In the union budget, the government will present the budgeted expenditures for the upcoming financial year. It is nothing but the money that is required for the government to be spent in the upcoming financial year. This money can be required for many purposes. Now, in order to get the money, the government will compile all the expenditures in the budget and along with this, the demand of grants which are presented by each ministries or the departments also will be compiled by the government. Under the demand of grants, if you see, generally one demand for a grant is presented in respect of each ministry or department. However, if you see for larger ministries or departments, even more than one demand can be presented. Now, as per Article 114, that is 114, Clause 1 of Indian Constitution, an appropriation bill can be introduced in the Lok Sabha for getting the money out of the Consolidated Fund of India, which is based on the demand of grants made in advance by the Lok Sabha and also based on the expenditures charged on the Consolidated Fund of India by the government. This appropriation bill is passed by the parliament, and once the president gives his assent to this bill, then it becomes an act. And once it becomes an act, it will give the authority to the government to use the money or to draw the money from the Consolidated Fund of India for various purposes it has planned to spend. Then also know that no amendment shall be made or shall be proposed to any appropriation bills in both the houses of the parliament once the appropriation bill is passed. Now this is as per Article 114, Article 114, Clause 2 of Indian Constitution. Now let us see the news article. It tells that the Lok Sabha has passed the Appropriation Bill number 2, 2019, so that the Union Government can withdraw around 98.1 lakh crore from the Consolidated Fund of India in order to meet its expenditure during the financial year 2019-20. So for every financial year, appropriation bills will be passed. Then the news article tells that the bill was passed by a voice vote. So in the Lok Sabha, if you see, when a motion is put to vote by the speaker, he or she says, those in favor of the motion say aye and those opposing it say no. And according to the voice vote, the speaker decides whether the bill is accepted or it is negated by that house. Here, in this case, it is the Lok Sabha. Now, have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This article is about the extension of the term of Finance Commission and the amendment of terms of reference of Finance Commission. Now, the syllabus that can be linked to the analysis of this news article is displayed here for your reference. Let us now start the news article. The news is that the Union Cabinet, which is chaired by the Prime Minister, has approved the extension of the term of 15th Finance Commission. If you see, it has been extended up to 30th of November 2019. This extension will enable the Finance Commission to examine various comparable estimates for the financial projections and also to finalize its recommendations for the period 2020 to 2025. Now, along with this, the Union Cabinet has also approved the amendment of the terms of reference of the 15th Finance Commission. The terms of reference generally provides the scope and the limitations of the Finance Commission. So, this amendment is to enable the 15th Finance Commission to address serious concerns regarding the allocation of adequate, secure and non-lapsable funds for the defense and internal security of India. If you see, the 15th Finance Commission was constituted by the President on 27th November 2017. It was constituted in the pursuance or the implementation of Clause 1 of Article 280 of the Constitution of India and also as per the Finance Commission Miscellaneous Provisions Act of 1951. The term of office is from the date on which the chairman and members assume office up to the date of submission of report or 30th of October 2019, whichever is earlier. So, under this, the commission was to submit its report on or before 30th of October 2019. Now, this has been extended. If you see, this report that is to be submitted by the Finance Commission will cover a period of 5 years starting from 1st of April 2020 till 2025. Now, the constitution of this 15th Finance Commission was in the backdrop of various major fiscal or budgetary reforms that was introduced by the Union Government in the past 4 years. The reforms like closure of the Planning Commission and its replacement with Niti Aayog, then removal of the distinction between the non-plan and plan expenditure, etc. If you see, the Union Budget for the financial year 2017-18 introduced a number of procedural reforms. Among this, if you see, the elimination of the classification of expenditure into plan and non-plan was also present. Look, there were two components of expenditure before the financial year 2017-18 budget. One is the plan expenditure and the other is the non-plan expenditure. Now, let us see the difference between the plan and non-plan expenditure. Plan expenditures are those expenditures that are estimated after the discussions between each of the ministries that are concerned and the planning commission. And non-plan expenditure means it is accounted for the interest payments, subsidies, which are mainly the food subsidies and fertilizer subsidies, then wage and salary payments to the government employees, then your grants to states and union territories, then pensions, police, economic services in various sectors, then even other general services such as tax collection, social services, grants to foreign governments, defense, loans to public enterprises, then loans to states, then union territories, and also foreign governments. Now, both these differences have been removed. So, it is just coming under one head, expenditure head. The next reform by the Finance Commission is the advancing of budget calendar by 1 month and passing of the full budget before the commencement of the new financial year, that is on 1st of February. Then also introduction of the goods and service tax from July 2017 was yet another. If you see, the terms of reference of the commission takes into account the above fiscal or budgetary reforms. So the task of determining the expenditure and receipts of the union and the state governments based on which the commission shall make its recommendation is time consuming. This is because checking for data consistency across time and data sets is a very challenging task. That is why the term of the commission has been extended for another 1 month. Then under the terms of reference of the commission, it is proposed to ensure an assured allocation of resources towards the defense and internal security imperatives of the country. The amendment to the terms of reference also provides that the 15th Finance Commission shall examine whether a separate mechanism for the funding of defense and internal security had to be set up. If it has to be set up, then the commission has to examine how such mechanism can be operationalized. Let us move on to the practice question discussion session. The first question is, consider the following statements with reference to the International Court of Justice or ICJ, and it has given three statements and it has asked you to choose the correct answer. Let us see the first statement. It tells that it tries individuals who are accused of war crimes or crimes against humanity. Here the first statement is wrong because the International Court of Justice does not have any jurisdiction to try the individuals who are accused of war crimes or crimes against humanity, as it is not a criminal court. Now, the individuals who are accused of war crimes or crimes against humanity are tried by courts such as the International Criminal Court. So, the first statement is wrong here. The second statement tells that its predecessor is the Permanent Court of International Justice. This statement is correct. So, the International Court of Justice's predecessor is the Permanent Court of International Justice, which was dissolved in the year 1940. Now, moving on to the third statement. The third statement is correct here. It tells that its judgments are binding upon the states and it cannot be appealed. The judgments that are delivered by the court in disputes between the states are binding upon the parties which are concerned. So, this is provided by Article 94 of the United Nations Charter. The charter states that each member of the United Nations undertakes to comply with the decision of the court in any case to which it is a party. Also, these judgments are final and they cannot be appealed in any other court. So, the third statement is correct here. Now, if you go by the elimination technique, we saw that the first statement is wrong. So, just by eliminating the first statement, you can get the right answer, which is option C, 2 and 3. But we also saw the other two options. So, the correct answer to this question is option C, 2 and 3 only. Moving on to the next question, the question is, consider the following statements with reference to rotavirus disease, and they have given three statements and have asked you to choose the incorrect statement, which means the wrong statement. First, let us see the first statement. It tells that it is a zoonotic disease which is caused by the cattle. Zoonotic disease means disease which is caused by animals. But know that rotavirus is not caused by animals. It is transmitted through fecal-oral transmission. It means that the germs that cause illnesses are found in the stool or fecus of an infected person and they are spread from one person to another. So, the first statement is wrong here. Let us see the second statement. It tells that it is the most common organism that causes severe diarrhea and death among children under the age of 5. This statement is correct. And the third statement is, rotavirus vaccine is a part of universal immunization program. So, during our analysis, we saw that rotavirus vaccine is a part of universal immunization program under the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. But if you see, Karnataka government is including it now only. So, don't get confused. It is already a part of universal immunization program. So, this question has asked for the incorrect statements. We saw that only the statement 1 is wrong or incorrect. So, here the correct answer is option A, 1 only. Moving on to the next question, the question is, consider the following statements with regards to appropriation bill. So, two statements are based on the appropriation bill. The first statement tells that the appropriation bill can be introduced in both the houses of the parliament. During our analysis, we saw that the appropriation bill can be introduced only in Lok Sabha as per Article 114, 114, Clause 1 of Indian Constitution. So the first statement is wrong here. It tells that it is introduced in both the houses of the parliament. It's wrong. It is introduced only in Lok Sabha. Let us see the second statement. The statement tells that once the appropriation bill is passed by the Lok Sabha and transmitted to Rajya Sabha, it is certified as a money bill by the speaker of the Rajya Sabha. This statement is correct. As per the financial procedure of the Rajya Sabha, the appropriation bill is certified as a money bill by the speaker of the Rajya Sabha. Now, if you see the procedure with regards to the money bills in Rajya Sabha, is same as in the case of other bills which are transmitted by Lok Sabha. But the only difference is, in case of other bills, the amendments that are made by the Rajya Sabha are adopted and the bill is passed. But in case of money bills, the amendments are recommended and the bill will be returned to the Lok Sabha. So this is the difference between a general bill and a money bill. So once the motion is adopted and the money bill is returned to Lok Sabha, if with recommendations or without any recommendations, the Lok Sabha, as per Article 109, has the option either accept or reject the recommendations that are made by the Rajya Sabha. But if you see, once the bill is transmitted from Lok Sabha to Rajya Sabha, Rajya Sabha has to return it within a period of 14 days from the date of receipt from the Lok Sabha. Otherwise, it is deemed to have been passed by both the houses, because once those 14 days is over, it automatically expires. So it will be considered that the bill is passed. So just know this difference. So the second statement is correct here. The question is asked for the correct statements. We saw that the first statement is wrong and the second statement is correct. So the correct answer is option B, 2 only. Let us see the mains question now. The question is, India, an aspiring non-permanent United Nations Security Council member, shall play proactive role in the multipolar world, but rule-based. And it has asked you to discuss. So today's editorial theme was on how India should conduct itself in global stage after becoming a non-permanent member of United Nations Security Council. The question asks you to discuss that India, which is aspiring to become a non-permanent member of United Nations Security Council, should play a proactive role in the multipolar world, but it shall be a rule-based one, nothing but a rule-based international order. So first discuss how India is aspiring to become a non-permanent member of United Nations Security Council. If you see, it had requested Afghanistan to give up or withdraw its claim for the candidature to become a non-permanent member. Then also it received the entire support of the Asia-Pacific group for its candidature. So you can mention all these points to substantiate that India is aspiring to become a non-permanent member of United Nations Security Council. Then come to the second part of that particular statement. Mention how India needs to play a proactive role in the multipolar world. So mention the reason why the world is multipolar first. Now, there are various themes to be discussed, like trade, security, terrorism, climate change, etc. So you can choose whichever themes that you find it easy to cover and then discuss that how the world is split on these themes. For example, trade, if you see, there are many trade issues that are happening between various countries. So the world is totally split with respect to trade. So just try to bring up some themes and build your answer on that particular theme. Then the statement in the question has mentioned that it shall be a rule-based one. So try to conclude the answer telling that India needs to play a role of consensus builder in actively engaging the nations based on a rule-based international order, that is following the rules that are agreed and set by various global groupings, so that both the developing and the developed nations would like to partner with India in the future. So in this way, you can try to frame your answer for this particular question. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of all the news articles taken up for today's discussion and also the practice question discussion session. Do like, comment and share the video, and do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for latest videos and updates. Stay focused and motivated, friends. Thank you.